before what I simply call queen out. As a source of reminder, I have not talked to you about purchasing this hardware, even at this level. So, step 5 talks about what I simply tag pin out. Pin out, what are pin outs? So if I look at my character LCD, as you can see in my hand, I want to know the numbers of pins that he has and what individual pins are doing. So I will just give that as an example, and I will give that 675 as an example. So if you have an LCD like this, you can actually browse it online. LCD has 16 different pins that are one VD. The 2 is PSX, the 3 is PEO, the 4 is RS, the 5 is Realize, RW, the 6 is Enable, and the 7 is 14 is actually D0 to D7, and the 15 and P16 are positive and negative of the target. So, you've been running your code on Arduino or LCD and everything has been compiling well, everything has been showing you that all is well, but you do not actually understand how to connect this particular device. So, this level, you are trying to understand what the individual pin as a source of example here. VDD is a grant. This is actually the fiber that powers the LCD module itself. VE is the contrast that controls the contrast of the LCD. RS is the register cylinder that goes directly to the Arduino. Read or write is when you are using your LCD to add a reading device that you can actually press something and it's reading the data from it. You connect pin 5 to I. That is why both. But when you are writing only to LCD, that means you are only displaying data, like the case we have, and you connect pin 5 to pin. Pin 6 is the enable pin that directly moves to the Arduino. Pin 7 to 14 is actually the data, like you are carrying the data that you are requesting, you want to actually display. So in most cases, you just have to use 4 of these just to save pin. So you can browse more MCB to LCD. Most significant and less significant. 5 points, 15 and 16 is actually the positive and the negative of the backlight. So it is expected of you to actually look at the particular hardware that you are working with now, even at this level. What are the pinouts? And I will explain the significance of this pin out now. Okay? I am measuring 10 temperatures, for instance, according to the problem that we have 10 temperatures. An individual MAC 675 has 5 connections, which I will explain now. You have grant, you have PCC, you have FCP, you have CS, and you have SCP. Okay, what is grant is definitely the low level voltage, while PC is the high voltage that you need to power the device itself. So basically, when you see something like this, the voltage and the voltage, positive and negative, this one is connected to the armor couple. So FCK is that prop line. CSC, let me call this initial. So this is the prop line. Or you can call it, that is stand for serial prop line. So CS is chip select. Some people use SS, so it is slave select, chip or slave select. Okay. Then, MISO is master in slave out. So basically, your MAC 675 works on a process called FPM communication, which is single peripheral interface communication. So, then, what we are trying to do is that now we are measuring 10 different temperatures using this MAC 675. using Matthew 7:5. Now, that is, I have 30 different things. This one, you can actually route them on the prompts so that you have 350cc. Then, all of them takes 350cc. But these 3 things are our consideration now. So, I have 30 things coming from Matthew 7:5. If you are an expert on Arduino, that you are actually following Matthew in STI communication, you can use this thing to teach standard devices, which is SDK and CS and MISO for all the things. So you have 20 things. Okay, this is for all the things. They maintain one and they maintain one, and that is just 10 plus 10 chips there. So you have 12 things, 12 digital things to talk about as a result of the practice. Okay. Still on. I will talk about this in the first one. The second one we are looking at is actually DH11 or 22. DH11 or 22 actually has basically 3 things. So we have basically 3 things. The grant, the data line, and this is. So if you look at this, basically only the data line is going to happen. As a result of that, you have 4 pins to be considered. For your SD module, go to number 3, SD module. SD module has 6 different pin connections. So you have RAND, you have PCC, you have MISO, you have MOSI, you have CS, and you have LC. So from this also, you can make sure that all of them maintain the same MOSI and SDK system. These guys also follow SDI communication. So you have to order out 2 more additional things there as a result of you using this. Okay, welcome for the 4th thing you are actually doing during this is we are actually looking at the next one, is your LC. I will take a little time to explain LC and to give you some notions about this. You are using 20 by 4 LC and you actually want to display a data. This 20 by 4 simply means 20 different colors like this. Then 4 rows like this. So just imagine I want to write T1 equal to 27.5. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I'm actually using 7 different lines to be able to write one particular vector. And I would definitely want to give a space between them to make it. So by the time I add another, so I can only write 2 different temperatures. So if by the time you look at it, these 2, 2, 2, 2, you can only display only 8 temperatures. So that limits you to the fact that you cannot actually use only 1 LCD to display all the temperatures. That is what you are using when you look at that project. It is actually using 2 different LCD. And individual LCD has 6 pins that goes to their unit, as I have shown you initially. So we are using 12 pins. Let me just say this in passing. There is a skill that you can use to reduce this thing to actually to reduce it, to reduce it by 5 so that you have some pins. You can browse on sharing the same data line for else. Later I can show you some people. So what is the unique BOSA? BOSA uses only 1 pin. Then if you are successfully with this, so let's calculate the number of total digital pins that we will need for this our project. So that is 12 plus 4 plus 2 plus 12 So this is 18, 20, 30, 21. So it means you have the total in consideration, in our consideration for your job. Then we'll carry this particular data that we'll get in this step, in the next step. Thanks for watching. Several avenues will exist in the market. So, based on your in-out and get from step 5, let's say you have consideration for the analog things that you will need, the digital things that you will need, the number of viewers that you will need. So I suggest that you browse on comparing Arduino boards. I'll just display, as you can see on your screen currently, there is a page showing now that talks about the different Arduino boards that you can get in the market and their consideration. So I'm showing you physically. So this is Uno. This is Arduino Uno with only digital, 14 digital from 0 to 13. So, and this is Arduino Mega that has about 55 digital pins. So that means you can actually use Arduino Mega for this job. So step 6 is simply about getting the right Arduino board that will do this job. Okay, let me explain a little bit further. You can see in that document that I displayed earlier some particular considerations for Arduino boards. I will just explain like two or three items. One is FPI, two is UART, three is numbers of analog and digital pins. And the most important is what we call flash memory. Okay. You have seen that your project actually is solely depends on SPI communications. And if you go ahead, you select an Arduino board that doesn't support SPI communications, you actually look that you are actually getting close to failing. That is what it means. Now what is UART? This universal asynchronous receive and transmit communications. That is what happens when you are sending data through your USB. So it's actually universal asynchronous receive and transmit. So what happens in this particular thing is that if your device does not actually support serial communications, you won't be able to do well here. When you are actually looking at a particular Arduino project that you have to use serial communication. I will explain a little bit about this. Using serial monitors on Arduino, if you have to use serial monitors on Arduino, I will explain. Let me give you one good thing about serial monitors. There are some error codes you don't want to display on LCD for your user, but you want, as you plug in the system, as you plug in your USB, you want to be able to see the error code on your system, on your screen. As an engineer, so when they call you for troubleshooting or for after service, so you want to be able to look into your serial monitor and the error code is showing on your system. So you can actually write a program that runs in serial monitors. And if your Arduino board does not support USB communication or UART, then you won't be able to do that. Analog and digital pins are the result of pinout that we discussed based on your sensors and your hardware that you selected in step 5. Step, the last one, flash memory. From your step 4, when you combine all those sketches together to give you one standard grade, look at the base at the lower end of your Arduino IDE. You will see the program memory used. So if you actually select Uno when you are combining it, you will see it's like maybe about 65% of the program memory. Arduino IDE will be able to suggest to you that if you use Uno for this job, you might run across instability problem. For the flash memory, you won't be able to do it. So, in consideration, one of those things you have to look into, very, very important, is flash memory. So step 6 is about having all this data that you are getting from step 1 to 5. You'll be able to use it to particularly select an Arduino board that will fit into your, and you'll be able to run all your hardware without any challenges. Several software packages exist in the market for you to simulate your circuit, for you to be able to push your programs and being able to test out everything is working. So even before buying anything, engineering these days is no longer a good engineer as it was before. That you actually have to buy all these ideas, spend so much money before you now discover that something is not actually working right. So you have to go and buy things. So I suggest that at this level, this particular thing, you have the software, you have the hardware. Go ahead, go to Google, download all the Protus versions or the Atom versions of the particular hardware that you are using and you are doing it. Try as much as possible to do the collection, pull the code, and try and run the simulate the circuit and look at what your results look like. So if there is anything that is not working, you can easily correct yourself before actually going ahead and purchasing anything you want to purchase. This will guide you in your costing. This will guide you. So if there's anything that is not working, I suggested that you jump back to step two of this project and look at this particular video and look at what is not working and what you can change based on the hardware that you are selecting. So I suggest that at this level, the additional knowledge of Protus, Atom, multi-sims is needed for you to be able to guide yourself from an error. You can actually go to a step further, like using your Protus to design your PCB, then send your PCB design to a PCB manufacturing on Novas, that they can actually manufacture the PCB for you. But if you still decided to do manual soldering, it's still very possible, manual etchings of your board, then to get your PCB out. So I suggested at this step, what you just have to do is connect your circuit online, as you can see one that has been connected on system. Simulate your circuit, look at what your results is like, and if everything is okay, then you can proceed to step 2. Step 3 involves you in selecting. Actually, when you get to the market, maybe an online store like AliExpress, like eBay, like DHA, you will definitely find infinite numbers of different suppliers, even on the same site, that are selling the same thing and a different price also. So it takes a painstaking looking at. I will give a candid advice here on how you will be able to go about this, about looking at what you can order. So look at two statements when you get to any of these online markets. Number one is order. You can see the number of people that have actually ordered their products. Like you see 10 different products, different prices. Before you consider the price, I suggest that you consider how many people have actually ordered the products. That shows you about the quality of the product. Yes, sometimes you will discover that the higher the price, the higher the quantity, the lower the price, the higher the quantity demanded. This follows economic rules. So this, actually my experience on AliExpress have shown that people tend to order products with low cost. So you actually see, but based on the grade of the of your client, what your client actually require, you can look for this. Two, look for time of arrival. Is this thing matching your project? And actually in project engineering there is something called main, I think EST, and you can actually look into that. That is expected time of delivery for your project. The third thing you have to look is shipping cost. You have to consider this very well, and even the cost of the project also, the total cost of the project. This is where you have to sit down, painstaking, to actually look at in the infinite numbers of the product of that same particular way that you are using, that you are so sure of, you have tested it, you have simulated it, you are so sure of your answer. You have to look at that similar product over and over again, especially in this day that you have several Arduino products, Arduino boards that are not actually the good ones. I suggested strongly that don't compromise on Arduino boards. You can compromise on other ideas because it might run into instability problems or your Arduino is not actually doing what it should be doing for you. So after you consider the shipping cost, then you can finally look at testimonies. Well, as a person, I will be sincere, I have not been doing well in this area. When you buy a product from an online store,
you install it, you use it very well, and the thing is giving you what you want, I think you should be able to go back to those people and tell them that, okay, I've used this product, so the next user that is coming, the next buyer that is entering the site, can look and read your testimony and say, okay, this product is working fine, I can use it, it's okay. Based on these people, you can check different regions or places where they have ordered the product, and if everybody is talking good about the product, then if all these are okay and they are yes, go ahead, all your ideas that you have actually selected, step 2, verify them in step 5, verify them in step 6, label them in step 6, go ahead, buy all of them, purchase all of them, and wait for them. Yeah.